This program was made possible in part by generous contributions from grandmothers everywhere and by viewers like you. Thank you. Welcome to this old PC. My name is John, and for a while now, I've been repairing these old machines to their former glory and exploring the depths of what they can do. Why don't you join me today while I explore this old PC?
Welcome back, everybody. I have here my Dell Dimension E510 that I previously covered, and today I'll be taking some photos of this motherboard, briefly talk about caps.wiki, and see if I can run Windows 10 on this old beast. First order of business is to tear this machine down for photos. The process of removing the motherboard isn't terribly exciting, and I've already covered a lot of the process in my first video talking about this Dell. So, with some video magic... A while ago, Shelby of Tech Tangents launched a new site geared toward being a valuable resource for anybody wishing to repair electronics, with a focus on the most commonly failed component. The capacitor. Caps.wiki was his brainchild, and it's already made a good bit of buzz. He's been adding information for things he's repaired on his Twitch streams, and plenty of users have been adding information of their own. Before the official launch, I added the motherboard from this PC to it, but I didn't have all of my references on hand to provide to the site, and I also wanted to post a decent looking photo to just add that little extra polish. I aim to rectify this and update my contribution to the site with more information. If you have any devices you've repaired, feel free to contribute, because as more information is submitted to the site, the more useful of a resource it will be. You can visit caps.wiki at caps.wiki. When you're done with this video, check out Tech Tangents. He's got some great vintage computing content and regularly streams on Twitch. At the time of launch, the Dell Dimension E510 was coming into a market that was starting to introduce 64-bit processing as the limitations of 32-bit architectures were starting to become a problem, chiefly the pesky 4GB memory limit. While supercomputers, mainframes, and high-end workstations already had 64-bit processors for decades, AMD brought the first mainstream x86-based 64-bit processor to the market in 2003. And shortly after, in the same year, Apple released the PowerMac G5, their first 64-bit machine based on an updated PowerPC architecture. Intel was late to the party, and it wasn't until the next year that 64-bit processing was brought to the Xeon lineup. And while the first Pentium 4 Prescott chips didn't feature 64-bit support, eventually Intel began rolling out support in some later revisions. By 2005, most new Pentium 4 models had 64-bit support. My machine came with a second revision of the Prescott chip, also known as the Prescott 2M, which all supported 64-bit processing. Specifically, I have the Pentium 4 HT630. It's a modern enough processor to have Windows 10 support, and the graphics card I have in it meets the minimum requirements of being able to support DirectX 9 or higher. Though with cursory research, getting the 64-bit version of the OS installed may not be a task that is possible. Intel's implementation of the x86-64 instruction set was incomplete and is missing some instructions Windows 10 uses. While I could get a 64-bit version of Windows XP running, it doesn't make much sense in my use case since not a lot of software from the era was designed with 64-bit in mind, and the chipset used was still 32-bit and supported a maximum of 4GB of memory anyways. With the machine back together and Windows 10 installed, here it is in all its glory. Since my first video last year, it never got sent out like I thought it would and stayed in my possession. I brought it to St. Louis for a New Year's throwback LAN party, and I installed an NVIDIA 9800 GT that I found in my attic to give this beast of a machine a bit of extra oomph so that games play smoothly. And for Windows XP and the games that can be run on it, it did that job beautifully. But I want this PC to beg for its mother and throw at it some modern software and see how it performs. While I wanted to add this NVIDIA GTX 550 Ti to the machine, the power supply doesn't have the provisions I need, nor is there really any room for a double height card. So I'll be limited, as the 9800 GT only supports up to DirectX 10, but there should still be some games I can try to play. I thought I would be slick and simply copy over a few games from my Steam library onto an external drive, and have Steam simply notice that the files are already on the drive when I go to install it. What I did not expect was just simply how slow the machine was going to be to simply use. I didn't film it, but first boot took over 2 hours post-install. It was a lot faster after that, but by no means as quick as a modern system. Without even playing a game, Windows was heavily loading the poor Pentium 4, and nearly all 1.5 gigs of RAM were utilized. Additionally, something was constantly accessing the hard drives. I'm not sure if it was some caching system with Windows, swap space finding itself being used, or just the fact that the machine might not ever get a chance to stop loading things from the hard drive since it both can't process what it's loading fast enough and can't fetch it fast enough from a spinning piece of rust. That said, I still try to install games through Steam. But before I talk about that experience, I wanted to see how well it would play YouTube at HD resolution. The browsing experience was less than stellar, taking forever to load Edge. Additionally, loading pages was just as slow as loading the browser. I don't blame Edge for this, since I'm a weirdo that just uses what comes with my OS if it's good enough, and Edge generally is just that. The modern web is just hard on older machines because websites utilize so much more than they used to. Once the page loaded, though, playing back one of my own videos was honestly not that bad. Granted, my first Dimension video didn't have a whole lot of motion until I started to recap the motherboard. It didn't seem like it was choppy in any way, and honestly, wouldn't have been that terrible of an experience if that was all you wanted to do. Just a little extra waiting for things to load. But getting back to things other than browsing, I discovered that most games I wanted to test did not have a 32-bit version available. In fact, Steam will not let you install them whatsoever, or even allow you to attempt it. But two of the games did have 32-bit versions. First up, Half-Life. This Valve classic shouldn't ever really have much trouble on any relatively competent machine that came out in the last two decades. We won't talk about my experience on that Gateway laptop that I last tried to play Half-Life on, but I will say it was pretty good on still. It ran at full 1080p resolution, at the highest settings available, and it ran just fine. This is when I had false hope about this experiment, and I should have figured it out when it took me over 3.5 hours to install a game that was already on the hard drive. While it only took about 15 to 20 minutes to install Half-Life over LTE, Wreckfest, the only game in the list of games I chose for this machine that would run in 32-bit mode, spent most of its time verifying game files. Not only did it spend most of its time verifying game files, but it also spent more time verifying them a second time, before downloading a few more files, verifying those new files, installing those files, and then verifying the installation again. And what did that reward me with? A black screen, which hid an error that stated that the game was unable to load a shader, and then proceeded to quit when I clicked OK. And with that, I gave up on this experiment. This is decidedly a machine that is best suited for XP gaming. And if you ever run anything newer, you're not doing much more than browsing the web, and possibly working on some documents. Slowly. So, should you do this? No. No, you should not. But that said, this was not a question of should I do something, but more along the lines of can I do something? And I could, so I did. The poor desktop barely could keep up with the OS itself, let alone any of the games I wanted to play on it. It could have been the fact that I didn't go with the solid state that meant loading application was going to be slow, but seeing the CPU nearly pegged out the entire time, I don't think that was the only thing slowing it down. But I'm impressed it even tried. The fact that over 15 years later I can run Windows 10 on this box, and that Nvidia had drivers available for this configuration, is just astounding, and a bit confusing. But here it is. A stupid experiment and answers to questions nobody else wanted to ask. Makes me think about how fast modern computers feel. Despite all the extra garbage modern operating systems throw at them, it really makes you appreciate the march of technology. I appreciate the patience you guys have had while I took a longer than expected break. I spent some time getting my new workbench and lab space built and set up, and then life decided that I needed to take a bit more time. This video was started before all of this, and I ended up refilming all of it. I've got one more video in the pipeline featuring the old workspace, which will come out in 2 weeks. This season will be a transitional one of sorts, where I work up some new filming, scripting, and editing techniques, work in this new workspace, and get started on some deeper projects. Engagement during the break has been encouraging, by the way. I appreciate all the new subscriptions over the last 2 months, and if you want to further engage with me, you can follow me on Twitter, where I yell into the void at times, and check out my Discord. And as always, thank you for watching.